Well, welcome everybody. Compared to the last talk, I want to go a little bit from the back end to the front end. I want to talk a little bit about if you experience performance issues or you want to improve your app's performance in general, what some tips and tricks are, or what a good way is to tackle these issues and to get a good understanding on what's actually happening. So, it might be an obvious answer, but why do you want to improve your app's performance? And that's, of course, your users. That's what they will be like if you don't. If you're using an app, it's all touch-based. If the screen doesn't respond immediately to what you're doing, users won't like to use your app, so it's pretty important. Apart from that, battery life is also important for users, and worse performance also leads to decreased battery life. One of the areas I want to talk about mostly today is during scrolling, because with modern devices it's pretty easy to write a good performing app. I wanted to create a demo application for this presentation. And wanted to buy. I really wanted to make a really worse application with really worse performance, and it was actually pretty hard on an iPhone 7. I did a lot of for loops everywhere, and I checked it on the device, and it worked pretty well. But during scrolling, it's obvious pretty quickly. Why is that? The main reason is. If you're scrolling, you want to have a good refresh rate of your screen. So let's assume all these lines are the moments you want to draw one of the frames. So then you start, the system draws a frame. Well, that's all good. And then you get the time to do your work. Then you do a little bit of work, and you're done in time before the next frame. That's all well. So the system draws the next frame. And then there's some work you need to do, which takes longer than expected, and you cross the boundaries. And then the system is waiting on it, because it's synchronous, and it doesn't have the time to render the frames. This means that you will drop frames. Now, looking at this graph, that might seem simple, you know, make the performance well so that it's between these boundaries. But on modern devices, the frame rate, which will lead to a very smooth experience, is usually around 60 frames per second. Even the newer iPad Pros, I think, is 120 frames per second. Just to give an idea on how many frames this is, it's this amount of frames in 1 second, which also means that that's just 17.6 milliseconds. You have time to do some work before you drop a frame. Now, this time even includes the time for the system to draw the frame. So it's not even the full amount of time you have for your work. Yeah. So if you're experiencing bad performance, so the UI is not responding well at all, that means you have usually two options. That's either improve the rendering of the frames, which the biggest part is done by the framework. So you can assist the framework a little bit, but it's mostly on Apple's hand. Or you can reduce the time you need to do your own work. First of all, it was also a little bit discussed in the previous talk, be cautious about this. If you're looking from a front-end perspective, with a really high level, I would say don't prioritize performance over readability or maintainability. But always keep it in mind. So if it's obvious that that there's a route which is perfectly fine, but it's more efficient, you should take it. But if there's a choice you have to make between a good maintainable code and code which is a little bit more performant, I would rather choose for the first one. A good example would be auto layout. Auto layout would have a little bit of overhead over managing it all yourself, but it's nothing compared to the benefits you will gain by just using auto layout for managing frames. And also very important is don't try to solve problems without identifying them first. So an example on this topic. Guess which of these lines takes the longest without using any tools. Just shout them out if you think you know which line is the most performant line. As you can see, it's probably pretty hard. And if you would also think about the difference it makes, because looking at this code, I would say, you know, maybe there's one line which takes a little bit more time than the other, but the difference is not that that big. If you pull it through Time Profiler, this is actually what you see. And I have no idea why, but that's how it is. So the best way to solve performance problems is just measure them first, so you actually know what problem you are solving. And to do so, Instruments is your friend. Are there a lot of people using Instruments on a maybe monthly basis, or is it? I see a lot of questions.
Yeah. Question. Oh. Raising my hand.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I already thought that's a lot of questions. So that's good. A lot of people use Instruments, and you should. I used a little sample for this. Don't ask me why, because this is not a talk about designing a good user experience from a design point. But if the task would be to have a list of people with a layout which is different every time, so there's a little curve in the layout. This is the example I wanted to use, and I think the frame rate of this beamer is not that good at all. But if you use it on the device, you will see that it's stuttering and it's not really usable. So we would like to see what is causing the actual problems. Well, to do so, you just open or you just start the instruments by choosing product profile or command I. Also, a good thing to notice is always use the right scheme. I think the default usually is one of the production schemes, and there's a big difference between a production scheme and our development scheme and a production scheme. So you can use instruments to find all the issues in development builds, but then you make a release build and all the code is optimized, so it will give a totally different result. So most of the cases you want to use instruments to debug your production code, because that's ultimately what you're going to ship. But at least be aware of that there's a big difference. It's also pretty important to use the physical device as much as possible, because performance on the simulator is not the same as performance on the device. In this case, we want to increase the time we spend in our own application code. So we use the Time Profiler for this. And the Time Profiler performs, as Apple says themselves, a low overhead time-based sampling of processes running on the system CPU. So basically what it does is, on certain intervals, it just samples what it's doing and just saves it so you can have an overview. But the important note is the sampling part, because it's not giving an actual representation of what it does, but it's just based on sampling. So if some line says it didn't execute at all, it's just basically because when it sampled, it never reached that line. So in this case, we run the application, you run the record button, and instruments is starting. In this case, we want to improve the scrolling performance, so we just wait until the application is in a little bit of an idle state, so we don't have any noise of the application launch or any other processes starting. Then when you start scrolling, you see an instrument at the top of the timeline, you see a lot of activity. Almost seems like it's using the entire CPU just for scrolling, and that's not what we want. Then underneath the timeline, you see the actual polling results. So in this case, I run it against a production scheme. That also meant that the symbols got stripped. So it's also important to make sure this is actually readable. So if you're looking at this, you have no idea what's happening. So you could choose to run the development scheme, because usually the development scheme still have the symbols inside. But you can also just go to the settings and locate your dsim file. So you can use it with actual production applications. That also means that you need to know where the DSIMs are, and the best way to just find them is check the build results for the latest build, and it's just somewhere there in the logs. You can also just select a part of the timeline, because in this case we are only interested in that part, because we are not looking at the application launch, so we want to narrow down the item we're actually looking at. You can also filter the events by clicking the call tree button at the bottom. This is a configuration I use often when I'm dealing with UI problems. So then I just disable the separate by thread, because I just want to know what's happening, and it doesn't matter on which thread. I also often check the hide system libraries button, because if something takes a long time in Apple's libraries, I cannot do anything about it, so I want to filter that out. But if you do, also be aware that you're filtering, so you're not seeing the entire story. So always keep it in mind that this might not tell the entire story. So it's good to use these settings if you want to just get a general basic idea of what's happening. So then you just go through to the list, and as you see here, it's already a little a small list with very specific results. Then you just click through them and see what's actually taking some time. So if you're looking there, you see the actual time and the percentages of the time it was actually spending in these methods. So you don't need to start looking at all these methods here, which are 1 millisecond, or because that's no bottleneck. But if you look at the top ones, that's like 10 seconds spending in these methods. That's a good place to start. So then you just open it up to see more and more details, and once you find something you think it shouldn't take that long, you can double click on it, and then you see the actual method with the sampling results next to it. I'm not sure what the default is, but I often see here that you use the percentage indication, so it says, for example, it's 50% here, 25% there, and 25% in the other one. But the problem with that is that because it's based on sampling, it doesn't give a really accurate result. Especially in functions which doesn't take a lot of time. So if it's under 5 milliseconds, there's a good chance that it says, you know, this one line is taking 100% of all the resources. But it isn't, but it's just the only line which got hit by the sample when it was sampling the CPU. But if you're looking at this list, you at least know that it's quite a lot of times that this line was actually hit, instead of comparing them between each other. So this is one of the examples. If you look at this, you could say, you know, it's 50-50, and these are the only lines which causing actual work. You can select the button at the top and change it to view as value. And if you do, you see that it's just 3 times for both. So, you know, it's 50-50, but both methods are probably as quick as they should be. But to get back at the results, if you look at this code, I wrote it as on purpose to be not so performant at all. So if you look at it, there's just a lot of work that's done that's not that shouldn't be there. The main reason is this is a layout, and the layout method is calling for specific layout attributes in a rectangle. And I just go over all the items and just return them all. In this case, this is a list with, I think, a couple of hundred items, and that's also one of the main reasons I finally got it working very slowly on my phone. It's because it's doing this hundreds and hundreds of times every frame that you're scrolling. So if you're looking at this, you have a basic idea of what's taking the actual time, and you can figure out why that might be. So then it's time to start improving. So I made a quick refactor on this, calculated the frame first to see if it's actually indirect. And if it isn't, then I just go to the next one. And if you look at the difference in the timeline above, so here this is where we started and this is where we ended, you immediately see a difference in the amount of activity that's happening in the CPU. And if you run this on the device, you see the immediate difference. So then I did a really small other improvement with just moving a little bit of variables around, and you see that it's slowly starting to decrease, and that it's actually getting better and better. This code still, it's not very performant at all, still. So it could be improved by doing making other improvements. But I think at this moment, there's a point where the UI is at least smooth and it's doing what it should be. And the other improvements are worth it if you really think this is a really important part of your application. But otherwise, it's probably performing pretty well. And because it's a really dynamic layout, it is really expected that it's taking at least a little bit of CPU time. So that's the CPU time part. You can also help you can help Apple by decreasing their work they need to do to draw frames. You can do that by using the Core Animation instrument. If you run that, it's looking pretty similar. You actually also see the time profiler CPU measurements here. But what you also see is here the amount of frames it's drawing. And you also see that in the table below. So this is already in a later stage, so we already improved the CPU performance. But if you look at the graph here, you still see that there are a couple of frames which are dropped. Because it's not always hitting this 60 frames per second. The gap here is expected because if the device isn't doing anything and the screen is idle, it shouldn't draw any frames. But now we only know that we are still dropping a couple of frames. So how do we know how we can help? The first one is to go to the debug options below. And there are a couple of options. The most easy one, which can save quite some time, but at least it's easy, is to enable the color blended layers. What that does is show you real time, so this also works on device, shows you real time which layers it needs to blend. So this label, for example, is transparent, but the background of the cell is white. So you could also set the background color of the label just to white, and if you do that, then all is green and it doesn't need to blend any layers. That means that Apple needs to do less work to render the exact same frames. You have more processing power left. Now, this is not a really performance-intensive operation by itself. But if you do that consistently, you can help the system by drawing more efficiently. And you also need to know that it's not possible everywhere because some UI parts, they need to be transparent. But sometimes they don't. And I think this is one of the cases you don't need to do when you're actually working on the application, but what is a good use of time to do it just before release, to just go over all these screens and see if you're not doing any unnecessary work. One of the other tools is the color off-screen rendered yellow. I think this is one of the most performance-impacting ones in this list. So if you do that on the application, you see that the avatars on the left side, that they are rendered off-screen. And what it actually means is this. We want to mask the avatar of the user. Can you actually see it there? Because I don't see the... Oh. Yeah, it's just total black for here. But first it needs to render the circle, because it's an asset in the project. Then it needs to render the avatar of the user itself. It's doing that all off-screen, and then it needs to render the combined result into the layer and into the screen. That means that it takes three rendering steps to do just this. And rendering, as you probably know, is pretty expensive. So you can improve that by, for example, instead of using an asset, because it needs to render off-screen because it doesn't know what the contents of the asset are. If you're just using pods or masks on layers, it's this shape, so it exactly knows where you need to mask. So you can do so directly, and it doesn't need to render off-screen. So if you do that, it's green, and then you can help the compiler out. Especially in Lisp, I think if you solve this problem in a lot of apps, the performance will go up pretty drastically. So that's basically it. I don't know if you see the difference on this beamer, but this is where we started. So if you're scrolling, it's pretty choppy. And this is where we ended. And that's just with, I think, 5 minutes of time debugging the using the time profiler and the core animations instrument. And that's it. Any questions?
Yeah, I've been doing iOS for like, I don't know, 7 or 8 years, but I'm embarrassingly bad at the profile. Like, is there anywhere where there's like a video of you explaining each one of the tools? In such a way that I can actually learn, because it's quite daunting to do it. There's not that much written in it online.
Yeah.
There are some good WC talks.
Yeah. That's true.
Yeah, I have to say, these are the two I use the most. I think the other ones are pretty interesting, but at least for very UI-driven apps, these are definitely the most important ones. There is also a lot of useful stuff on memory management and finding leaks, but especially if you're using...
I usually end up finding the leaks. Like,
yeah. But especially if you're using Arc, the chances are, if you're just using UI and high-level stuff, is that finding memory leaks is pretty hard, because it's usually not a memory leak, but it's more of a retain cycle, because Arc is using doing the memory management for you. So I think if you're doing very UI-driven Swift applications, you don't find a real big use in the leaks instrument.
I disagree, actually, because the memory leak instrument also shows retain cycle.
It does?
It does.
Oh. I also learned something today. then it is really useful.
So how often, you said that you use this for a release maybe or something? How often do you use the first part? Only when you encounter problems, or is it a regular part of your normal development process?
Yeah. It really depends on the project. Sometimes you have projects with a tight deadline, and then I just postpone it to the end, and I just always keep performance in mind to make some decisions, but to actually measure it and see where the bottlenecks are, I just postpone it to the end until there's an actual performance issue you directly mention. But if the tension is not so high, I think it's actually very... I really like to do it also. It's also quite satisfactory to improve your performance, even if you don't notice the difference on screen. So if I have some time, I just do it once or two, twice a week to just give a basic overview. And that's just running it once and just seeing if there's any really unexpected behavior. Yeah, it's just a really good tool, and you need to know how to use it, and then it's the best for you to decide when.
It's become like ingrained into your process, and without having a cause to do this, I would not think of like, oh yeah, I need to debug my UI performance. But
if
it becomes part of your process, then it's just natural.
Yeah, if you think performance is important, then I think it's a good way to, or it's a good idea to get it into your process. But I think for a lot of people, especially for me, I think it's just also fun to do. But that's also a problem to just not overdo it, especially for UI-driven driven applications. Because
you also sell it to clients or your boss that you're doing this part, or maybe they think like, yeah, but it works.
Yeah, well, in a lot of cases, you don't need to spend an entire day debugging all these performance issues. You know, you get a lot of benefit by just doing it for half an hour or just before release. Then you will definitely notice the difference.
More questions? No? Well, thank you very much.